Good morning, church.
Morning.
Good morning. Good morning to all of you who are tuning in online. As lots of church folks like to say, we have never done it this way before. But here we are. This morning we are offering virtual worship. We will be praying morning prayer. And I want to thank my brothers in Christ, my fellow ministers, Michael Templeton, St. Mary's pastoral physician, and David Brierley, who does really too many things at St. Mary's to list, but today he's our technical director and our lecturer. So thank you to both of you. Thank you to all of you who are tuning in and who are members of this very special congregation, and all of you who are guests tuning in to our worship. Thank you. Our physical space will be closed at least until March 27th. We will continue to offer as much spiritual support and connection as we can to one another. You can continue to be in touch with us in all of the usual ways, email, telephone, and we will get back to you. So without further ado, I am going to sit down and we will sing together our opening song.
Far in safety, though you do not know
Rend your hearts and not your garments. Return to the Lord your God. For he is gracious and merciful, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love. All may kneel as they are able. Dearly beloved, we have come together in the presence of Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, to set forth his praise, to hear his holy word, and to ask for ourselves and on behalf of others those things that are necessary for our life and salvation. And so that we may prepare ourselves in heart and mind to worship him, let us kneel in silence and with penitent and obedient hearts confess our sins, that we may obtain forgiveness by his infinite goodness and mercy. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. Please stand as you are able. Lord, open our lips,
and our mouths shall proclaim your praise. Glory to the Father,
and to the Son,
and to the Holy Spirit,
as it was in the beginning,
is now,
and
will be forever.
Amen. The Lord is full of compassion and mercy. Come, let us adore him. Come, let us sing to the Lord. Let us shout for joy to the rock of our salvation. Let us come before his presence with thanksgiving and raise a loud shout to him with songs. For the Lord is a great God and a great King above all gods. In his hands are the caverns of the earth, and the heights of the hills are his also. The sea is his, for he made it, and his hands have molded the dry land. Come, let us bow down and bend the knee, and kneel before the Lord our Maker. For he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture, and the sheep of his hand. Oh, that today you would hearken to his voice. The Lord is full of compassion and mercy. Come, let us adore him. Please be seated.
A reading from Romans. Since we are justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Through him, we have obtained access to this grace in which we stand, and we boast in our hope of sharing the glory of God. And not only that, but we also boast in our sufferings, knowing that suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope, and hope does not disappoint us, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit that has been given to us. For while we were still weak, at the right time, Christ died for the ungodly. Indeed, rarely will anyone die for a righteous person, though perhaps for a good person someone might actually dare to die. But God produces his love for us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Much more surely then, now that we have been justified by his blood, will we be saved through him from the wrath of God. For if while we were enemies, we were reconciled to God through the death of his Son, much more surely, having been reconciled, will we be saved by his life. But more than that, we even boast in God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Through him we have now received reconciliation. The word of the Lord.
Thanks
be to God.
Let us pray together, Canticle 10. Seek the Lord while he wills to be found. Call upon him when he draws near. Let the wicked forsake their ways, and the evil ones their thoughts. And let them turn to the Lord, and he will have compassion. And to our God, for he will richly pardon. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, nor your ways my ways, says the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. For as rain and snow fall from the heavens, and return not again, but water the earth, bringing forth life and giving growth, seed for sowing and bread for eating, so is my word that goes forth from my mouth. It will not return to me empty, but it will accomplish that which I have purposed, and prosper in that for which I sent it. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
A reading from the Gospel according to John. Jesus came to a Samaritan city named Sychar, near the plot of land that Jacob had given to his son Joseph. Jacob's well was there, and Jesus, tired out by his journey, was sitting by the well. It was about noon. A Samaritan woman came to draw water, and Jesus said to her, "Give me a drink." His disciples had gone to the city to buy food. The Samaritan woman said to him, "How is it that you, a Jew, ask a drink of me, a woman of Samaria?" Jews do not share things in common with Samaritans. Jesus answered her, "If you knew the gift of God and who it is that is saying to you, 'Give me a drink,' you would have asked him, and he would have given you living water." The woman said to him, "Sir, you have no bucket, and the well is deep. Where do you get that living water? Are you greater than our ancestor Jacob, who gave us the well, and with his sons and his flocks drank from it?" Jesus said to her, "Everyone who drinks of this water will be thirsty again. But those who drink of the water that I will give them will never be thirsty. The water that I will give will become in them a spring of water gushing up to eternal life." The woman said to him, "Sir, give me this water so that I may never be thirsty or have to keep coming back here to draw water." Jesus said to her, "Go, call your husband and come back." The woman answered, "I have no husband." and saying, I have no husband. For you have had five husbands, and the one you have now is not your husband. What you have said is true. The woman said to him, Sir, I see that you are a prophet. Our ancestors worshipped on this mountain. But you say that the place where people must worship is in Jerusalem. Jesus said to her, Woman, believe me, the hour is coming when you will worship the Father neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem. You worship what you do not know. We worship what we know, for salvation is from the Jews. But the hour is coming, and is now here, when the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and truth. For the Father seeks such as these to worship him. God is spirit, and those who worship him must worship in spirit and truth. The woman said to him, I know that Messiah is coming, who is called Christ. When he comes, he will proclaim all things to us. Jesus said to her, I am he, the one who is speaking to you. Just then his disciples came. They were astonished that he was speaking with a woman. But no one said, What do you want? Or, Why are you speaking with her? Then the woman left the water jar and went back to the city. She said to the people, Come and see a man who told me everything I have ever done. He cannot be the Messiah, can he? They left the city and were on their way to him. Meanwhile, the disciples were urging him, Rabbi, eat something. But he said to them, I have food to eat that you do not know about. So the disciples said to one another, Surely no one has brought him something to eat. Jesus said to them, My food is to do the will of him who sent me and to complete his work. Do you not say, 4 months more, then comes the harvest? But I tell you, look around you and see the fields are ripe for harvesting. The reaper is already receiving wages and is gathering fruit for eternal life, so that sower and reaper may rejoice together. For here the saying holds true, one sows and another reaps. I sent you to reap that for which you did not labor. Others have labored, and you have entered into their labor. Many Samaritans from that city believed in him because of the woman's testimony. He told me everything I have ever done. So when the Samaritans came to him, they asked him to stay with them, and he stayed there 2 days. And many more believed because of his word. They said to the woman, It is no longer because of what you said that we believed, for we have heard for ourselves, and we know that this is truly the Savior of the world. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thanks be to God.
Thanks be to God.
Thanks be to God.
I wish to speak to you in the name of God, who is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. This morning, as Michael and I were talking about how to pull this together, and David and I were talking about how to pull this together, something that we've never done in our community before, Michael sent me a text which has a wonderful photo posted by one of his pastor friends on Facebook. And it's a sheet of notebook paper written with Sharpie. Dear everybody, since I've not pastored people through a pandemic before, I don't know all the answers, but I'm paying attention to science, praying for wisdom. Together we'll take courage, be patient, consider the least of these, press onward while loving our neighbors. Love with a heart, your pastor. P.S. Wash your hands. I thought this was a wonderful, wonderful way to put words to what I am feeling as a pastor, but I'm sure what almost all of us are experiencing and feeling moment to moment as we walk through this completely uncharted territory. I've been thinking that it's great for us as followers of Jesus that we are walking through this pandemic in the season of Lent. Because after all, we began this season in the wilderness. And this is certainly a wilderness. In the first week of Lent, I was preaching essentially these words that I heard from a member of our congregation who was awaiting a diagnosis, which has turned out to be cancer. And her words were this: the bottom line is trusting God. The bottom line is trusting God. The bottom line is trusting God. We've never done it this way before, for sure. And one of the things that's happening is that we're all getting a new vocabulary, right? The word pandemic is not one that has rolled off our tongue before this week. We have new words like epidemiologist. And one that is baffling to me, social distancing. Social distancing. So I'd like to play a little bit, just for a few minutes, with this idea of social distancing in a time of spiritual closeness. Social distancing in a time of spiritual closeness. Now, I am not going to go into what social distancing means, because you can go on many websites right now and figure that out. It means everything from signing a petition to self-quarantine to staying 3 or 6 or 9 feet away from one another to go ahead and go out to the bars and restaurants, but just don't touch anyone. What I do know is that in this wilderness time, we are also experiencing spiritual closeness. And in the gospel that David just read, and that gospel which is being read the world over this weekend, we are being called spiritually close to the heart of Jesus and to the hearts of one another the world over. In the gospel that we just heard, we heard that it is Jesus who is initiating all spiritual closeness as he meets with that woman. Jesus, who had every reason not to come close to her, right? could have been a version of social distancing, because this was a Samaritan woman. Now, just her identifiers, Samaritan and woman, would have been cause for Jesus to have separated. Samaritans were divided from Jews, religiously, politically, socially. And as a woman, it would have been very strange for Jesus, a Jew, to be engaging this woman in lengthy conversation. But engage her he does, and he initiates spiritual closeness, connection, and transformation of her life. It's interesting because at first we think this woman is there and she thinks that she is meeting a need of Jesus, giving him water. But in the end, we see that it is he who blesses her with living water and with knowledge that he is the living water, the Messiah. Jesus initiates also spiritual closeness with us. In Christ, we know that there is nothing that can separate us from the love of God. Not any self-imposed spiritual, social distancing, not anything that a pandemic or a virus can do, not even sin. Jesus will call us close again. In the past week in our community, and in countless ways, in family and friend relationships, in social media, which I think is a way that we can stay connected in these times of not touching one another and maybe not seeing each other, I've experienced two examples that I want to share with you about life in our church here at St. Mary's. The first one is that we have a pastoral care team here. And Pauline is the woman who's in charge of that. And early in the week, I called Pauline and I said, you know, I think that we're going to be experiencing some changes in community, and we need to reach out to those who are most vulnerable. Do you think you could organize some people to get in touch with our homebound members and anyone that you know is sick? And she said, yeah, I'd be glad to do that. She said, I'm feeling a little sick myself. I have a cold, but I'm going to get on that. About 2 hours later, she called me back with a full report of how everyone is doing. And she said, you know, I feel as if I've sort of been miraculously healed the whole time I was reaching out. I didn't even think about my own cold. That was 3 days ago, and four times since, Pauline has been in touch with me to see, you know, how else she can help. So in this time of social distancing, our community has been drawn spiritually close in ways that we don't usually practice. This afternoon, just before I went home to pull together this homily and eat a bit of lunch, a mother in our community got in touch with me, and she's recently brought home her college student and is home with her high school student and her husband, and she said, you know, I'd really like to organize us to meet the needs of our community. And now I have these two teenagers at home, and I'd like to organize the whole community of teenagers so that if there's anyone we know who needs something, we can be the people to provide. So, in the time of social distancing, as school is canceled and colleges are closed indefinitely, we reach out, living our baptism, seeking and serving Christ in others. So those are just two examples. And I know that for each person who thinks that they might be in need, or who thinks that they might be meeting the need of another, like that Samaritan woman, the more that we reach out and recognize Jesus as the source of our living water, we will be brought close. We will be brought close. It is in the wilderness journey that Jesus was tended by angels, and it is in our own wilderness journey that we will be angels and will be tended by angels as well. Amen. Let us join in the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth.
I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Show us your mercy, O Lord,
and grant us your salvation.
Clothe your ministers with righteousness.
Let your people sing with joy.
Give peace, O Lord, in all the world.
For only in you can we live in safety.
Lord, keep this nation under your care.
And guide us in the way of justice and truth.
Let your way be known upon earth.
Your saving health among all nations.
Let not the needy, O Lord, be forgotten.
Nor the hope of the poor be taken away.
Create in us clean hearts, O God.
And sustain us with your Holy Spirit.
Almighty God, you know that we have no power in ourselves to help ourselves. Keep us both outwardly in our bodies and inwardly in our souls, that we may be defended from all adversities which may happen to the body, and from all evil thoughts which may assault and hurt the soul. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. Amen. Lord God, almighty and everlasting Father, you have brought us in safety to this new day. Preserve us with your mighty power that we may not fall into sin, nor be overcome by adversity. And in all we do, direct us to the fulfilling of your purpose. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty and everlasting God, by whose Spirit the whole body of your faithful people is governed and sanctified, receive our supplications and prayers, which we offer before you for all members of your holy church and for the whole world, that in their vocation and ministry they may truly and devoutly serve you through our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Lord, we pray for all those in danger and in need, the sick, the suffering, those who are afraid and anxious, and the most vulnerable around the world. For those who are traveling and those who are quarantined. We pray for all first responders and healthcare personnel. We pray for all in positions of power and leadership throughout the world, our nation, and in our local government. We pray for those on our prayer list: Sheila, Marilyn, Regina, Jimmy, Alice, Rita, Priscilla, Jason, and those we name silently or aloud.
For Julie's sister, for Tucker.
For Lydia as she travels. life and grieving those who have died. Let us pray together the general thanksgiving. Almighty God, Father of all mercies, we, your unworthy servants, give you humble thanks for all your goodness and loving kindness to us and to all whom you have made. We bless you for our creation, preservation, and all the blessings of this life, but above all for your immeasurable love in the redemption of the world by our Lord Jesus Christ, for the means of grace and for the hope of glory. And we pray, give us such an awareness of your mercies that with truly thankful hearts we may show forth your praise, not only with our lips, but in our lives, by giving up ourselves to your service and by walking before you in holiness and righteousness all our days, through Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be honor and glory throughout all ages. Amen. Spirit, be with us all evermore. Amen.